Hello. Welcome to the online service of Shore Presbyterian Church. It's good to have you worshiping with us. Join me in a word of prayer for our time in the scriptures. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we ask for you to reveal yourself to us. Reveal who you are in even these traits of a deacon, that we would know who we are to be in light of you, who you are transforming us into. Help us, Lord, to focus on the main idea of what it means to be a deacon today, the idea of serving. Help us have servants' hearts just like you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so today we're moving into the section of 1 Timothy that lists out the qualifications for the office of deacon. And we'll see a lot of similarities between what's required for deacons and what's required for elders. And in that case, I won't spend much time going over the traits that have already been addressed. And so if there's something that I don't address in the sermon today, feel free to jump back to my sermons on elders and hear what I have to say about those particular character traits. But I'd rather focus on the specific nature of a deacon, which we arrive at by the title itself. The word deacon, or diakonos in Greek, means servant. And all Christians are called to be servants. But the text today and other texts also lead us to believe that there is a certain office within the church that servant leaders are called to. Now, much like with elders, the list of qualifications we will look at today are more character traits than they are skills or giftings, right? A deacon is to be a certain kind of person. And they'll demonstrate these traits long before they're called to the office of deacon. But certain people are called to the office of deacon. And the thing is, we don't actually know, we don't have that much from the Bible that tells us what the role of a deacon should be. We have to infer from various texts and from the example that Jesus gave us and from the early church what a deacon is to do. Because of this, there's been some confusion surrounding the office. In the Catholic Church, a deacon is just the first step in the process of ordination. Deacons aid the priests in their parish duties by visiting the sick, providing spiritual guidance in the community, acting as a servant of God. In addition, they witness marriages, perform baptisms, preside over funerals and burial services, outside of Mass, and they distribute the Holy Communion and preach homilies. All right, so that's basically the job of a priest, but it's priest in training, you could say. That's what a deacon is in the Catholic Church. And in many Baptist churches, deacons function as the leadership, or in other words, as the elders of the church. Still, in other churches, deacons are people who manage the finances and take care of the building and the property. And our Book of Church Order says this about the role of deacons. It is the duty of the deacon to minister to those who are in need, to the sick, to the friendless, and to any who may be in distress. It is their duty also to develop the grace of liberality in the members of the church, to devise effective methods of collecting the gifts of the people and to distribute these gifts among the objects to which they are contributed. They shall have the care of the property of the congregation, both real and personal, and shall keep in proper repair the church edifice and other buildings belonging to the congregation. In matters of special importance affecting the property of the church, they cannot take final action without the approval of the session and consent of the congregation. All right, so that's what the PCA believes the role of a deacon is. But which of these is right? Well, the way I like to think about it is that a deacon is the lead servant. And by this, I mean that there isn't just one task or one role that a deacon is called to. They aren't just the groundskeepers, even though they may keep the grounds. They aren't just mercy ministers taking care of the poor, though they may minister mercy to the poor. They are, in fact, the people in the church who get things done. And what do they get done? Whatever needs to get done. Now, deacons can also delegate responsibility to other church members. They shouldn't be the only ones doing things in the church that need to get done. But they are the leaders of that doing. They serve by leading, and they lead by serving. Throughout Acts, we see servants delivering messages, collecting offerings, serving widows and the poor. Just because someone is serving doesn't make them a deacon, but a deacon definitely serves. All right. Even though the noun deacon or servant doesn't appear in Acts 6, which is the passage where men are called upon to serve the widows and make sure they're getting food. Many believe that this passage, Acts 6, establishes the norm for deacons, because the verb serve, diakoneo, does appear in verse 2. And there was something here in this early church that needed to get done. Widows needed to be given food. It needed to be distributed fairly. Godly leaders were needed to get it done, because apparently it wasn't happening fairly without leadership, and the elders, or in this case, apostles, needed to focus on the ministry of the word and prayer, and so men were appointed. Now, I doubt that these seven men did all the serving, but they were the leadership appointed to oversee the execution of this specific task. I think probably a concise and helpful way to consider the elders and the deacons in the church is this. The elders lead by protecting the doctrine of the church, teaching it, praying, and shepherding the people. They represent the people in the higher courts of the church, and they develop vision for the church, and they keep the church on mission. That's what elders do. The deacons are appointed to lead logistically in implementing the mission and vision of the church. In other words, they lead by serving, and they serve by leading. Now let us look at Paul's qualifications for these lead servants in the church. Turn with me to 1 Timothy 3, verses 8 through 13. God has something to say to you today. Hear it and apply it. Deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience, and let them also be tested first, then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Jesus Christ, in Christ Jesus. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Now, there are three things that I want to address from this text today. First, I want to briefly look at the traits of a deacon. Specifically, I want to look at anything that's different here from the list of traits for elder. Then I want to discuss verse 11 and why women or wives are mentioned. And finally, I think it's valuable to consider the gains of those who serve well. So let's first look at the traits. All right. In short, we can just say that just like an elder, a deacon must be a person whose life reflects the faith that is working itself out in them. All right. We see a large overlap in characteristics between elders and deacons, if not verbatim, then with synonyms or like ideas. All right. And there's a couple ideas here that are new that I'd point out. One is that they are not to be double-tongued. Now, double-tongued is a very literal translation, and I'm glad the ESV goes with it because I think it paints the picture of this undesirable trait well. To be double-tongued means to say one thing and to do another, like a hypocrite, or to say one thing to one person and a different thing to another person, or like having no integrity. Now, certainly this is important for a deacon who must be able to control their speech, for they might be privy to personal information of others, that and they must be reliable to get the job done which they are assigned. So being able to control your tongue, you control your speech, not talk about people that you're having to help with financial things, those kind of things, is a good trait for a deacon. But this doesn't mean that an elder can be double-tongued. That's silly. In fact, because these lists are so similar in describing character traits, you can almost see it as one list that Paul kind of broke up stylistically in order to cause between these two offices in order to make it easier to read. And the next unique thing that I want to point out is in verse 9. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Now, first, it's important that we understand what Paul means when he uses the word mystery. When we use the word mystery, we usually mean something that's unknown, all right? But when Paul uses it, he always means something that was previously unknown that now has been revealed. And in 99% of the time, when he uses the word mystery, he's referring to the unveiling of God's plan of redemption. Now, sometimes he's referring to different aspects of that plan of redemption, and sometimes he's referring to the gospel as a whole. And here, I believe he's referring to it, the gospel as a whole. Basically, he's saying that a deacon must be someone who believes the gospel to the point where they have inculcated it into the way that they live. Remember, even the demons believe the gospel, but they haven't put their trust in Christ. They haven't repented. They haven't let their life be changed. To hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience means you have earnestly put your trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and your life reflects that change. And again, this is something that needs to be true for an elder as well. Now, the final thing I want to point out is the idea of being tested that we see in verse 10. And let them also be tested first. Then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Now, first it says to test them also, all right, which means that the candidates for elders should also be tested. And this shows how this list is pretty continuous, right? There's a continuity to it. But what this testing looks like exactly isn't clear. It could just be a time of being a layperson in the church so that your character could be observed, or it could be more in depth. Now, our denomination is very thorough in its examination process, right? For ordination, whether it be for pastor or elder or deacon. To be ordained in our denomination, a candidate will be examined on Bible knowledge, on our system of doctrine as articulated in the Westminster Confession of Faith and the catechisms. They'll be tested on our Book of Church Order, and they'll be tested on personal character. And actually, I think that our denomination is weakest when it comes to examining the character of a candidate, even though this seems to be the central idea of the examination, right? So that they can prove themselves blameless, is what the scripture says. And at this point, we depend a lot on a congregation to know a candidate and know their heart and know their character. But I'd like our church to kind of grow in that area. And so in the coming year, I would like to implement a formal discipleship process that addresses not only head knowledge about the faith, but also life application and accountability. I'd like this to be mandatory for people who want to be officer candidates. So that, and it could be open to anyone who wants to do it, but it must be for those who want to be candidates, so that we as a church are able to know that our candidates are men of integrity. And again, that doesn't mean that you have to be perfect to be a candidate, but it means that you're accountable and that you're growing in your faith. You're not just living in sin. You are making strides forward. You are growing in sanctification. All right, to sum up all these traits, and let me throw this in too. The list of elders says that they must be apt to teach. This list doesn't have that, which means I think that a deacon doesn't have to be apt to teach, although they might be. And one of the tasks elders could give to a deacon would be to lead a study or something like that. And so they don't have to have that one, but I think they could. They can. Now, to sum up all these traits, I want to apply an analogy that I've heard. I think a deacon should be a servant who is more like a soaker hose than a spray nozzle. All right, think of watering your garden. If you go out with a spray nozzle on the end of your hose, you can aim the water at certain plants and you can avoid other plants. You can even release the handle and cut off the supply of water entirely. But a soaker hose has little holes all over it that drip the life-giving water to all the plants in the garden with no specific control over it. Likewise, I think a deacon is a person who exudes service and leads by example. Service just drips from their pores because it's part of their character. They're being shaped by the Holy Spirit to resemble their Savior, who washed his disciples' feet and who said, "Whoever wants to be greatest must be servant to all." A deacon candidate can't aim their service at specific people or cut it off when they're tired. They serve not to receive reciprocation. They serve because it's who they are. They're disciples of Jesus Christ, and his loving service naturally flows out from them. That's how I want us to think about people who might be the deacons in our church. Next, let's look at verse 11 and this mention of women and wives. Verse 11 says, "Their wives likewise," in the ESV, "their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things." Okay, well, these traits, again, we've seen them in the list of elders, basically. But why this mention of their wives or women? The ESV betrays its bias in this translation because in the original Greek, there isn't anything to indicate the possessive word there. There isn't anything in the text to indicate that. And the word for wives can also mean just women. They're the same word. You just have to use context clues to know whether it means wives or women. So this could be wives likewise must be dignified, etc., etc. Women likewise must be dignified, etc., etc. It could be either wives or women. Though it does seem out of the blue that we would move from elders as an office in the church to deacons as an office in the church to random women in general. So I think when we look at this, we need to think of it, we need to interpret it as either women who are in some relationship to the deacons, now maybe they're their wives, maybe they're deacons' assistants, or as referring to another office like deaconess, and some churches have that as an office. I think it's unclear from this text alone which option we should assume. Now, Romans 16:1, however, points to at least Phoebe, a female, having the title of deacon. It says, "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a servant of the church at Cenchrea." Now, here you see it translated by the ESV as servant, but it's the same word, diakonos. It's the exact same word. So together, I think they do make a valid argument. You could make a valid argument that women can be ordained as deacons. You could make that. And so people who hold that view, I wouldn't look down on them. However, our denomination holds that deacons can only be men. And that this reference to Phoebe being a deacon just means servant, not an official deacon. And so I will submit to my brothers and fathers in the church and in this denomination, which means that in our church, women cannot be ordained deacons. But what else is clear from this passage is that women functioned as servants in the church. They performed diaconal roles. Now, whether they have an official title or not, they serve the church and its ministry. Now, to that I say that a true servant doesn't need a title. Men or women should serve out of the abundance that Jesus Christ has given them, regardless of title. And when someone sets the example of being a servant, people will follow them whether they have a title or not. So I encourage all Christians to follow in Jesus' footsteps and serve. Lead people by your example, regardless of your gender. We need the full body and all of the gifts that God has provided our church through you all in order to be the best church that we can be. And you may not get the recognition you deserve. You might not get the title. You may even be treated as less than. But we bear up under this for the sake of Christ. That's part of what being a servant means. I'll give you an example. Charles Spurgeon and his wife, according to a story in the Chaplin magazine, would sell but refused to give away the eggs that their chickens laid. Even close relatives were told, "You may have them if you pay for them." As a result, some people labeled the Spurgeons greedy and grasping. They accepted the criticisms without defending themselves, and only after Mrs. Spurgeon died was the full story revealed. You see, all the profits from the sale of eggs went to support two elderly widows in their church. Now, because the Spurgeons were unwilling to let their left hand know what the right hand was doing, as we see in Matthew 6:3, they endured these attacks of being called stingy in silence. You see, serving is the reward in and of itself. Look for people who live that idea out when considering future deacons of our church. Look for people who want to serve because of what Christ has done in their lives, not because they want the accolades. Finally, let's look at gains. All right, when you hear the word gains, you probably think of packing on muscle by pumping iron and guzzling protein shakes, right? Well, that's not a bad analogy, actually, for the type of gains that you receive when serving, right? As you exercise your service, you will get these gains, all right? So it's kind of like pumping iron, I guess. Now, and this is true for deacons and lay people. Paul lays it out for us in verse 13. He says, "For those who serve well as deacons," but I say this also as lay people, "if you serve well, you will gain a good standing for yourselves. For they will gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus." Now, the first thing that a person who serves well gains is good standing for themselves. It's a reputation. A servant is known as a servant. Now, you might say that that's contradictory to what I just told you about the Spurgeons and not letting your left hand know what your right hand is doing. and it is biblical, right, that you should serve out of the abundance of your heart, not out of the motivation to receive accolades or attention. But Jesus also says, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. You see, if you're truly a servant at heart, you can't hide it all the time. People will notice, and your reputation will reflect what God is doing in you and in your life. Not to mention, you'll bring a positive reputation to the church where you serve, which many people believe is full of hypocrites. One of the biggest reasons people don't go to church is because of the people in the church. And so we want to give the church a good reputation by being servants. The second thing a servant gains is great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. What I believe this is talking about is what we call assurance of salvation. Now, salvation itself and assurance of salvation are two separate things, and we must think of them as such. Salvation is the unilateral work of God in your life. He declares it from before the foundation of the world when he wrote your name in the book of life. He accomplished it by sending his son Jesus to die in your place on the cross, receiving the just punishment for your sinfulness, and he applies it to you through the work of the Holy Spirit. And ultimately, he consummates it when Jesus comes again and judges the world. Now, Ephesians tells us that we were dead in our transgressions, completely unable to rescue ourselves and in dire need of a Savior to make us alive again. But once we have been made alive, God does call us to participate in the working out of our salvation. Now, the theological word for this is sanctification. And it basically just means that in response to God's grace, we begin to live according to God's will. We start becoming the person God saved us to be. And as we do this, we start to experience assurance of salvation. Because we see our lives changing for the holier, we are assured that God is working in us and that he has saved us. It's kind of like in a marriage. When the relationship is growing deeper and more intimate and we are communicating well, we are assured that our marriage will last. But when we're fighting and being selfish and distant, we lose that assurance. We feel like maybe this marriage won't last. Maybe it will end in divorce. The only difference is that God is the judge, and he's the one who decides whether to grant divorce or not. And if you're saved, he will not grant divorce, no matter how obstinate, no matter how rude you become. He will work for your salvation. He will work in you, your sanctification. But you can't really, when you're doubting, you can't really know that, right? Like you might think, am I saved? I'm not acting like I'm saved. And that's a good thing. That's a blessing to have that question come up. We only receive assurance of salvation when we see God working it out in our lives through our obedient service. Now, I know this can be tricky because it almost sounds as if I'm saying that if you do the obedient service, you will be saved. But the Bible is clear that rather, if you are saved, you will do the obedient service. Only, we also struggle with sin and backsliding and doubt. So in those moments, we may lose our assurance of salvation. We might not feel saved, but if God has chosen us, we will not actually lose our salvation. Moral of the story, don't let your feelings drive the train. In a train with three cars, fact, faith, and fiction, fact drives the train, which pulls faith, which pulls feeling. All right, don't let those get rearranged. The fact is that Jesus Christ died on the cross to save all who come to him in faith and repentance. You can place your faith in that fact and trust that it is true, therefore living an obedient and service-filled life. You might not always feel like serving. You might not always feel like you're saved. But feelings don't drive the train. You tell your feelings, get in line with what I know and believe to be true. I'll tell you a story. Queen Victoria once attended a service in St. Paul's Cathedral and listened to a sermon that interested her greatly. Afterwards, she asked her chaplain, "Can one be absolutely sure in this life of eternal safety or eternal security, right? Or assurance of salvation?" His answer was that he knew no way that one could be absolutely sure. Now, this incident was published in the court news and came to the notice of a minister named John Townsend. And after reading of Queen Victoria's question and the answer she received, he prayed and he sent the following note to the Queen. "To Her Gracious Majesty, our beloved Queen Victoria, from one of her most humble subjects, with trembling hands but heart-filled love, and because I know that we can be absolutely sure now for our eternal life in the home that Jesus went to prepare, may I ask your most gracious majesty to read the following passages of scripture, John 3:16, Romans 10:9-10. I sign myself your servant for Jesus' sake, John Townsend." Now, John Townsend was not alone in praying about this letter to the Queen. He took others into his confidence and they offered up prayer to God in Her Majesty's behalf. And about 2 weeks later, he received the following letter. "To John Townsend, I have carefully and prayerfully read the portions of scripture referred to. I believe in the finished work of Christ for me and trust by God's grace to meet you in that home of which he said, I go to prepare a place for you. Signed, Victoria Guelph." I don't know how to pronounce it. Guelph. Now, after Queen Victoria's discovery of Christian assurance, she used to carry a small booklet to give away, and its title was Safety, Certainty, and Enjoyment. And this is what she found in Christ. Friends, these things are yours in Christ also. Latch on to them and serve your church and your neighbor accordingly. Christ served you by living the life you could not live and dying the death you deserved to die. Serve him by caring for your brothers and sisters and even by loving your enemies. Have a character that is constantly being shaped into the image of your Savior. Serve well, and you will bring glory to your name and to his, along with the assurance that he is working in you for the better. And remember, a true servant leads by serving and serves by leading. Amen? Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we come before you, humble servants, and we ask, Lord, that you would work your salvation in us, that we would be conformed more and more to the image of your Son, that our character would reflect these attributes we saw in our scripture today, and that these attributes would seep from us like a soaker hose onto those around us, to our brothers and sisters in the church, and to our neighbors and enemies even. Lord, use us as your servants to bring glory to your name and to bring people to an understanding of your gospel message, the mystery of the faith. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.